Good evening. My name is Robert Dijkgraaf. I'm the director and Leon Levy professor here at the Institute for Advanced Study, and it's a pleasure to welcome you to this lecture. Certainly those of you who are here in Wolfenstein Hall, also those of you who are in the overflow room, so we even have, I think, an overflow room to the overflow room, and I've understood that tickets are still sold on the black market outside at high prices. We have a tradition at the Institute of having lectures on public policy, but I'm particularly happy to welcome to this one, which is the first a new series of lectures curated by the School of Social Science. At the end of the lecture, there will be a question and answer period, and then there will be a reception in the Fould Hall Commons building, and that's the main building of the Institute for Advanced Study. This series of lectures aims to address issues of broad, important relevance to contemporary politics, social conditions, and scientific matters. As you all know, tonight's lecture will feature Thomas Piketty, professor at the École des Hautes Études en Sciences Sociales in Paris and at the Paris School of Economics. In today's talk, Professor Piketty will touch on themes from his famous book, Capital in the 21st Century, which the New York Times described at that point when it came out as the most important economic book of the year and perhaps of the decade, and perhaps it's even running for the title of most important book of the century. We'll see. I'd like to thank Didier Fassin and the School of Social Science for the work on this series and for inviting such a dynamic speaker, and I don't think we could have a better launch of this series. You know, it's whenever you have a party, you worry whether enough people will show up, and then you worry if not too many people will show up. And so it's a great luxury to have you all here. So now it's my pleasure to introduce Didier, the James D. Wolfenson Professor in the School of Social Science here since 2009. He's an anthropologist and sociologist and medical doctor who has conducted fieldwork, among others, in Senegal, Ecuador, South Africa, and France. Currently, he focuses on the themes of punishment, asylum, inequality, and the politics of life, and is developing a reflection on the public presence of the social sciences. He is the author of many books, including, for instance, Prison Worlds, an Ethnography of the Carceral Condition, which provides empirical and theoretical tools to reflect on the meaning of punishment in contemporary societies. So, again, a warm welcome to all of you at this series. Now I'm almost, as director of the Institute, required to provide an Einstein quotation at every event. And my favorite one in this aspect is his saying, and it also comes down to how proud we are to have a School of Social Science here. But he said there were two things that Einstein said fascinated him: the physical universe outside and the moral universe inside. And I think it's a wonderful quote, and so I hope you enjoy the lecture, and please join me in welcoming Didier Fassin to the podium.
Good evening. The School of Social Science is extremely happy and honored to host the first speaker of the new series of public policy lectures, Professor Thomas Piketty. In a response to the authors of a special issue of the French journal Annales, dedicated to the discussion of capital in the 21st century, Thomas writes, quote, "I would like to see it as a work of social science rather than a book about history or economics. Too much time is lost in the social science on petty quarrels about boundaries and often rather sterile arguments. These oppositions can and should be overcome," unquote. This multidisciplinary understanding has been the defining approach of our School of Social Science since its beginnings, as well as our view about economics, a discipline not merely centered on mathematical modeling and statistical theories, but fully immersed in the social science and enriching it through a constant dialogue with history, sociology, anthropology, law, philosophy, political theory. Thomas's work is exemplary of this approach, and his presence today on this special occasion is therefore particularly significant for us. when the 970-page volume of Le Capital au XXIe siècle was published in France, it was almost unanimously praised by critics. Reviewers were fascinated to learn that an economist would cite Honoré de Balzac. But it did not immediately become a bestseller. Interestingly, it is its translation into English and its journey through the United States from university campuses and the White House to radio stations and cable news networks that transformed it into what the New York Times, another quotation, called the latest overnight intellectual sensation and the big thing book of the moment. Then the US success story trickled down globally, so to speak, including in France, where the essay lived a second life, becoming what French journalists usually call un succès de librairie. That the United States would have been so receptive to a 700-page volume, English is more concise than French, and English language publishers print in smaller letters, that such a volume, moreover, with a title a la Karl Marx, would have such a success, is certainly revealing of the quality of the work as much as it is of the predicament of the country with regards to its increasing economic and social inequality. The publication came after the 2008 subprime mortgage crisis, which had deleterious effects on the most fragile segment of society, and after the 2011 Occupy movement, which emphasized the growing gap between the top 1% and the rest of the population. But instead of focusing on the present moment, the book offered a perspective on wealth and income inequality in the long durée, going back to the 18th century, thanks to the creation of a unique world database and shedding light on a variety of phenomena, including the impact of slavery and of colonization in the production of inequality. In particular, it showed how during the 20th century, in various Western countries and most dramatically in the United States, the evolution of both wealth and income inequality formed a U-curve with a decline in the first decades, a low plateau in the mid-century, and a steep increase from the 1980s on. This exploration of the past thus illuminates our comprehension of the present, both in terms of repetition of similar mechanisms and production of new logics of accumulation. It reminds us, for instance, that the very countries, notably Germany, which have recently been adamant in requiring that South European nations, Greece in particular, reimburse the totality of their public debt, even at the cost of their future growth, had in earlier periods their own debt reduced, deferred, or even canceled. Other times, other customs. Thomas obtained his master's degree in mathematics at the École Normale Supérieure and his PhD in economics jointly at the École des Hautes Études en Sciences Sociales and the London School of Economics. Appointed assistant professor at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology and then recruited as research fellow at the National Center for Scientific Research in France, he became in 2000, at the age of 29, the youngest director of studies ever elected at the École des Hautes Études, where he was a few years later the co-founder and director of the Paris School of Economics, where he is still a professor. Among a dozen books, principally in French, three have been translated into English, Capital in the 21st century, of course, The Economics of Inequality and the forthcoming High Incomes in France in the 20th century. Worth noticing, the World Wealth and Income Database that he has created is in free access online and open to commentators. His most recent book, Pour un traité de démocratisation de l'Europe, for a treaty on the democratization of Europe, co-written with three colleagues, published this year and already translated in 20 languages, should become an important contribution to the much needed debate on the European project after Brexit. Indeed, Thomas is not only a social scientist, he's also a citizen of the world, as well as a participant in the public life and even the political sphere in France, where he has been the economic advisor of several presidential candidates in the recent period. Earlier this year, Harvard University Press published a collective volume with some of the most prominent economists worldwide entitled, After Piketty, The Agenda for Economics and Inequality. Tonight's lecture, Reflection on Inequality and Capital in the 21st Century, is in some way another After Piketty, this time by himself. Join me in welcoming Professor Thomas Piketty.
Thank you all for your warm welcome. So let me first say how happy I am to be here tonight. Let me apologize first for the fact that my English sounds a lot like French, as you can hear. So I hope this will be okay. So this lecture is going to be based partly on my book and partly on some new research that we've been doing with a very large international team of scholars since then. Generally speaking, I should say that all this work really comes from a very collective international research program. I started working on the inequality, on the history of inequality in France more than 15 years ago, and then I was very fortunate to find with Tony Atkinson, who unfortunately disappeared at the beginning of this year, with Emmanuel Saez, Gabriel Zucman, Facundo Alvaredo, and dozens of researchers around the world. We've been collecting this historical database on income and wealth, and this is something which I could never have done on my own. So today I will present a number of selected evolution, but you can find more material online, in particular on the WID.world database, where you will find a lot of historical material on income and wealth. I'm sorry I cannot put my book online. My publisher will disagree, but I'm sure you can find it somewhere if you want. But in any case, at least you have all the data is available online, and this is really the book is just a photography of what was available at a given point in time, but there is a lot more that we are collecting. Almost every week we put new data online. So in this lecture, I'm going to try to focus on these four points. So first, I will present a number of findings regarding the long-run dynamics of income inequality. And here, probably the main lesson, I will try to summarize one of the main lessons of my book, which is that during the 20th century, the reduction of income inequality was largely the consequence of very large political shocks, wars, revolution, depression. And it's only at the end of these shocks that elites accepted a number of social and fiscal reforms, which in the end, brought the reduction of inequality, and these are important lessons for the future. The second point will be about the return of patrimonial or wealth-based society, and I will argue that there are deep structural reasons why the concentration of wealth might keep rising in the future, and this calls for a need for, in particular, more democratic transparency on wealth so that we can adapt our policies. Then I will move to two points which are not sufficiently well covered in my book. In particular, point number three will be about inequality in emerging countries, the post-colonial world, and I will present a number of estimates on what I refer as extreme inequality regime in the Middle East, in Brazil, South Africa, where we observe inequality level which can be even higher than in developed countries. And I will stress the need to go beyond Western perspective on inequality. Probably, in my view, the most important and the most interesting consequence of the success of my book is that it allowed us to access more data in more countries, so in particular a number of countries like including Brazil, South Africa, but also Korea, Ivory Coast, were not able to access financial archives and fiscal data before the success of the book, and partly due to the pressure put by journalists, by public debate and discussion on the government and some of these countries, we were able to access more data, which allows me now to to extend the scope and to try to remedy when what is really one of the main limitations of my book is that it is too much Western-centered. This is not entirely my fault. This is partly due to data access reason, but also, as I will argue later, the intellectual perspective on my book is certainly a bit too centered on the historical experience of the West with inequality, and it's very important to move beyond that. And finally, the last point will be more about the political consequences of rising inequality. And I will try to present some reflections on what is certainly one of the most troubling paradox of our time, which is that rising inequality, you might think that it would lead to rising political demand for redistribution and therefore rising class-based politics, if you want, with a redistribution between income or wealth class group, and we seem to be observing to a large extent exactly the opposite with a rising xenophobic populism, identity-based politics. We've seen that with Trump, with the Brexit, certainly in my country. We've seen that recently, although the extreme right was defeated a week ago. And I will try to present some new reflections and evidence on the changing electoral structure in line with rising inequality in order to give some hints to explain this paradox. Let me make clear that I certainly don't have a complete answer for this paradox. You know, I don't think anybody has, but you know, it's not a reason not to try to make progress. Okay, so let me start right away with the first point about the long-run evolution of income inequality. So here, the major lesson from history is what I call here the end of the Kuznets curve. So the Kuznets curve was a very optimistic theory about inequality and development, which was first proposed by Simon Kuznets in the 1950s. So to be honest, Simon Kuznets himself did not believe too much in the Kuznets curve, but he proposed this interpretation of what he had found, and at the time, partly for political reason, during the Cold War period, in the 50s, 60s, many people, in particular in the West, wanted to believe in a sort of optimistic theory. So what was the optimistic theory? The optimistic theory of the Kuznets curve was, okay, in the first stage of industrialization, say in the 19th century in Europe or in the US, you may have a rise in inequality, but then in the advanced stage of industrialization, as more and more workers join the high-paying sector of the economy, you should have a natural reduction of inequality. And this was a possible interpretation that was put forward for the most important finding of Kuznets, which was a reduction of inequality in the US between 1913 and 1948, which in fact, as we're going to see in a minute, was largely due to political shocks and unusual circumstances, which if you read Kuznets, you can see that he was aware of that. But then at the end of his book and article, he sort of suggests that there might be some more general mechanism to explain this decline in inequality in advanced stages of development. And in the context of the 50s, 60s, you know, of course, this was potentially a very powerful political message, in particular for the newly independent countries who might be tempted by communism. And this was a very important message to tell them, well, please be patient, you know, don't make mistakes. You know, at some point, the reduction of inequality will come together more naturally. So I think the Kuznets curve was largely proposed for wrong reason. And now that we have more data, half a century of more data in many more countries, we can see that during the 20th century, it's really due to major shocks that we had this reduction of inequality. And in particular, it is through this shock that elites accepted fiscal and social reform, which in many countries, in particular in my country, in France, were refused up until World War I. And so the general conclusion is that political determinants, if we look at the history of the inequality in the 20th century, are more important than purely economic determinants. So let me show you some results. So this is a graph on the evolution of inequality in the US. So the first part of the graph is the decline of inequality which Kuznets found in the 1950s. So we, you know, redid the same computation as Kuznets, and you know, Kuznets did not have Excel, but he did the computation right. We have no disagreement with him, except that now we have another half century, and also we have several dozen countries instead of one, which gives us a different perspective. Okay. So Kuznets, let me make clear that the work he did was very innovative. He was the first, so he was an American economist, Ukrainian-born American economist, who was the first economist to compute national accounts for the US in the interwar period. And his next task after World War II was to use the data coming from the federal income tax, which had been created in 1913 in this country. And he used the data from 1913 to 1948 to compute the changing share of total income going to the top 10%, which basically dropped from almost 50 to a bit more than 30%, which is a very big drop. Okay? If we had complete equality, the top 10% should have 10% of total income, and complete inequality should have 100. So in practice, for income, it typically goes between 30 for low inequality country, 50 for high inequality country, or even 60 or more than 60% in country like South Africa or Brazil, as we will see. So this is for concentration of income. If we look at concentration of property, wealth, it's typically more extreme. It can go from 50% for the top 10 for actually the most egalitarian country to 90% for the most concentrated country. So just to get the orders of magnitude right. So Kuznets was the first economist to compute such an evolution. So people had been talking about inequality forever in the 19th century, David Ricardo, Karl Marx, but you know, they basically had no data. So which puts serious limits on what you can say, or actually sometimes puts no limit on what you can say, which is even more problematic. So Kuznets had only one country, the US, for a 35-year period, but still it was a lot more than what we had before. So all what we have done in this research project is to extend this work to many more countries, longer time periods. This had never been done before, I think largely because of the very strict boundaries within the social sciences, which brings us back to what Didier was saying. You know, this is a work, you know, using this historical fiscal data, which for a long time was viewed as too economic by historians and too historical by economists, so that in the end nobody was doing it. To be honest, it's also much easier today, you know, with modern information technologies, to collect this kind of data in a systematic manner. Anyway, this comes from work with Emmanuel Saez. So you can see that you have a very sharp reversal of the trend starting around 1980, with levels of inequality which can be very volatile when you include capital gains, you know, depending on the stock market, of course. But you can see that even taking away capital gains, you have a clear upward trend. And in the end, here in 2012, you have a level of inequality which is higher than before the crisis in 2007, which was itself higher than 1929. So you have a very, very strong evolution. And we want to understand more about, you know, where is this going to stop? Why is this happening? So one first take at the issue is to compare with other countries. So if you look at this. This is a comparison with Europe, and also I have put decennial averages instead of so these were annual series, so that you have all this short run variation. If you want to focus on the long run trend, it can be useful to look at decennial averages. You can see that Europe is a complicated continent, as you know. So this is actually the GDP weighted average of Germany, France, Britain, and Sweden. So this is mostly Western Europe. And you have variation, of course, within Western Europe. But basically, you have a pattern like the Britain will be a bit closer to the US as compared to France and Germany. But still, there is a European pattern which is different from the US pattern. So there were income concentration was higher in Europe a century ago. And then in the recent decades, a very large gap emerged between Europe and the US. So you have rising inequality everywhere, but it is much less strong in Europe. If you now look at Japan, which is the third part of the rich world, of the developed world, you can see that Japan is in between Europe and the US, but in a way closer to Europe. So the question is, how can we account for this? So you can see that it's not going to be enough just to talk about globalization, because globalization happened not only in the US, but also in Japan, in Germany, in Sweden, in France. So you need a bit more than this. So this is not saying that globalization and competition with China, emerging countries, is not important. You know, it is certainly important, but it suggests that there are differences, you know, different institutions, different policies between countries can also make a difference. So depending on your education system, your labor market institution, different countries can allow or can help different groups, larger segment of their population to benefit or not from globalization. So you need, you know, country-specific explanation in order to explain such large differences between countries. So what are more specifically, you know, what are examples of such institutions? As I say, you know, what the, probably the most striking feature in the evolution of the US is not only the rising top shares at the, you know, for very high incomes, but also a real collapse of the bottom 50% income share. And probably this has to do with extreme inequality in the US educational system in terms of access to skills and education. Also, we observe in the US an unprecedented rise of very top managerial compensation, which is very difficult to explain simply on the basis of education and product or productivity, or at least I couldn't find it in the data we have. And I think in some cases it has more to do with the ability of very top managers to put the right people in the right compensation committee in a way that is that involves other processes that, than just education and unequal access to education. Falling minimum wage in the US, falling role of unions, changing labor market institutions more generally matter. Whatever, you know, the exact combination of explanation, and people can disagree about the respective role of education, corporate governance, progressive taxation, falling minimum wage, I think all of these are important, but whatever your preferred combination, the general conclusion is that institutions and policies matter. So let me show you what I think is probably the one of the most spectacular findings of recent research we have done with Emmanuel Saez and Gabriel Zucman, where we try to decompose the bottom income groups in a much more comprehensive manner than we did before, where we focus mostly on the top income groups. You can see this collapse in the bottom 50% income share, which is really quite spectacular because basically the bottom 50% and the top 1% have exchanged position in terms of income share. Okay, the bottom 50% used to have 20% of the total and the top 1% 10%, and basically now it's the opposite. Okay, so we're talking about really big numbers. You know, it's not, you know, it's not just a few individuals who are making a lot of money, but who are so few that they do not really matter from a macroeconomic perspective. You can see that here it really matters from a macroeconomic perspective in the sense that the rise for the top one is of similar magnitude as the decline in the bottom 50. So how can it be that the income share of the bottom 50 can be less than the income share of the top one? Well, you know, this simple simple mathematics, the bottom 50% is 50 times more numerous. So if you want the bottom 50% to have less in terms of total income share of the top one, it must be that on average, the average income of the top one is more than 50 times the average income of the bottom 50. And so this is exactly what happened, which is that the average income of the top one used to be 27 times the average income of the bottom 50, and now it's 91 times. So when it was only 27 times, because the bottom 50 is 50 times more numerous, their income share was roughly twice as large, 20 instead of 10. But now, because that it's 81, you have the opposite. So you know, I think it's important when you, sometimes when we talk about inequality, we do it in a way that is a bit too abstract with the Gini coefficient that nobody understands about. I think looking at income shares and looking at concrete income levels is important because it allows you to realize more, you know, what we are talking about. So the average income of the bottom 50% adult in this country has stagnated at about $16,000 in dollars of today, well, dollars of 2014, but almost dollars of today, which is not a lot, really. I mean, you all know about academic wages or other wages, you know, $16,000, you know. Now, this is pre-tax, pre-transfer. After tax, after monetary transfer, it's about the same because the tax that bottom 50% pay is comparable to monetary transfer. If you add in-kind transfer, so that Medicare, Medicaid, in particular health transfer, you will add about $5,000, so you will have 20 instead of 15, and this has increased a little bit over time. Now, does this reflect rising welfare for those who receive the health kind transfer? or also rising welfare for the providers of healthcare whose price has increased a lot over the period. It's a complicated issue. In any case, $5,000 of in-kind transfer, you know, this is the equivalent of 1 week of pre-tax income for the top 10% and 1 day for the top 1%. Okay, so this is the attention, if you want, that the bottom 50% is getting in terms of redistribution. In any case, it's clear that when you have such a dramatic collapse of the share of the bottom 50%, redistribution is not enough. You also need to find policies that will increase the pre-tax income of the bottom 50% of the population in terms of access to primary assets, so access to education, access to property, access to bargaining power. You need to change the institutions, the policies, so as to increase these pre-tax income shares. Okay. So what are these institutions? Well, I mentioned minimum wages. So the minimum wage in the US at the federal level used to be higher than in France. Now it has become quite higher in France. So some people in France think it is too high. I'm not so sure. I think it has more to do with how you deal with the fiscal system, the payroll tax, in addition to the minimum wage. But in any case, I think in the US it has become too low, too small. You know, when you have $7 an hour, whereas in 1968, 69, you had more than $10 an hour. So everything is in dollars of 2013. So this is why when you have inflation during the Reagan years or Bush years and a fixed nominal minimum wage, you have an erosion of the purchasing power of the minimum wage during this period. So at the end of the day, you have a real minimum wage today that is less than 50 years ago, which is quite spectacular. Another reason for rising inequality, as I said, is of course unequal access to education. So this is a particularly spectacular graph coming from work by Raj Chetty and Emmanuel Saez. So you see, so this is, you have the parental income rank and you have the percentage attending college at age 18 to 21. So basically you have almost the 45 degree line. Okay, you go almost from 0 to 100%. Well, if your parents are very poor, not quite, you know, if your parents are very poor, you still have a 20% chance to make it, and if your parents are very rich, you only have a 95% chance to make it. Okay, so it's not, yeah, it's not the 45 degree line, but you know, it's very close. And of course, when you are at the bottom and you go to college, you don't go to the same college than when you are at the top. Okay, so you know, this is an example where I think you know, there is really an enormous gap between the official discourse about US society, equal opportunity, meritocratic dream, and the reality of what we observe. So I think it's important, you know, the elites always have a lot of imagination to justify inequality, and they make claims about, you know, why inequality in the end works for everyone, etc. And you know, sometimes these claims can be justified, but sometimes they are not. They are just based on, you know, false information, some form of fake news or whatever. And I think it's important to put these claims under public scrutiny and to have more transparency, not only about inequality of income and wealth, but also who benefits from public services, from access to education, and you know, look more at this kind of information. Finally, let me also mention that the very high top 1% earners are very predominantly men. Okay, so this is also related to gender inequality and to some form of patriarchal structure to a large extent. So the share of women in the top 1% has increased a little bit in the US, but it is still extremely low, you know, 15% at the end of the period. It is, of course, not unique to the US. You have almost exactly the same numbers in France. If you continue the trend of the past 20 years, you know, you would need to wait until 2102 to get to 50% and the middle of the 22nd century for the top 0.1%. So I think you need, in many cases, you need other policies if you want to make progress and change this kind of inequality structure in a shorter time frame. Let me now move to the issue of wealth inequality and what I call the return of a patrimonial or wealth-based society. So inequality in wealth partly comes from inequality in labor income. So far I have talked mostly about inequality of income and particularly labor income. Inequality in wealth is partly due to inequality of labor income, because wealth partly comes from saving out of labor income, but it's more complicated than this. Inequality of wealth also involves inheritance, involves financial markets, financial returns, so there are other processes that matter. And here what I would like to argue is, first, at a macroeconomic level, we see a very large rise of wealth to income ratio in recent decades, which reflect transformation in the nature of wealth, the relative price of assets, real estate and other form of assets, the development of new form of property, including intellectual property. And we need to look at this changing nature of wealth if we want to understand the evolution of wealth to income ratio. So if you look from a very long run perspective, you can see that in Europe, you have a big decline in the aggregate value of wealth. So a ratio of 600-700% means that what people own in property, real estate, business assets, financial assets, net of all debt, represents between 6 and 7 years of income on average. So of course, some people own a lot more, some people own a lot less, but on average, this is the aggregate value of wealth until World War I. Then you have a huge decline following the war, due to destruction, due also to the lack of investment. So a big part of the private saving between 1910 and 1950 was used to lend money to the government through public debt, which then was used to pay for the war and to destroy for the rest of the capital stock. So this is a very stupid process, but this is the history of Europe over this period. And finally, at the end of the period, you also have policies such as rent control policies or nationalization or financial regulation, which reduce the market value of wealth, which doesn't mean that the quantity of capital is inferior. So the market and social value may be different. Now, you have a big recovery of wealth to income ratio since World War II, which, you know, to some extent correspond to reconstruction, to some extent correspond also to the fact that at the end of the period, you have aging of the population and lowering of growth rate. Also change in the legal system, so I mentioned the issue of rent control. If we look more precisely at the recent decades, you can see that pretty much everywhere, so these are the top 9 developed economies, you have this big rise in wealth to income ratio. Part of it, so let me say, you know, sometimes in economic textbook, we are being told that the wealth to income ratio or the capital to output ratio should be constant. So, you know, be careful with economic textbook. You know, sometimes in economic textbook, when we don't know much about something, we just assume it's a constant. And of course, if you have only one data point, everything is a constant. But in fact, there's no reason why it should be a constant. Even in the simplest economic model with a one good model of capital accumulation, it all depends on how much you save and invest relative to how fast you grow in terms of population and productivity growth. And any ratio, you know, in the standard textbook model with capital labor substitution could be a constant. If you move to more realistic and more sophisticated model, it is even more the case. Once you have, for instance, two-sector model with the relative price of housing, there are even more reasons why the ratio between wealth and income can take many levels. So you can see the Japanese housing bubble around 1990. You can see the Spanish bubble, which is even bigger. So this rise in wealth to income ratio is not necessarily bad in itself, because it could come, after all, with a very egalitarian property structure, where everybody will own the same share of the stock market, of the housing stock, etc. Except that in practice, it's not what you have. It's not egalitarian property, so you have a lot of property concentration. And also, even if this was relatively egalitarian property, when you have such a high ratio of wealth to income, it also means that financial crises can be very damaging, that the regulation of capital becomes a very big issue. So if you make a 10% mistake on the price of your real estate in Spain, when the wealth to income ratio is 600-700%, so 6-7 years of GDP, you're going to have real consequences for the economy that are going to be much bigger than in 1970, when the ratio was much lower. Another reason for the rise in the wealth income ratio has been privatization. So an extreme case are the ex-communist country, well, China is still supposed to be communist, but a big part of the capital stock has been privatized. So of course, you increase the private wealth to income ratio. If you look at the share of public property in national wealth, you can see, so in China, it has gone from 70% to about 30%. In capitalist country, it has always been less than 50%, but it used to be, you know, significantly positive, 20%, sometimes 30% in the 50s, 60s, 70s, which is not incomparable to China today. So this was like the mixed economy period of the 1950s, 60s. This corresponds to a situation where government owned significant public assets and there were very limited public debt because a big part of the public debt around 1950 after World War II had been cancelled, as Didier was saying, or through inflation or directly through debt restructuring. So there were significant public assets. Whereas today, net public wealth has become negative in many countries. In particular, you can see in Britain, in the US, in Japan, it has become negative. So what does it mean to have negative public wealth? It means that the public debt is higher than the public assets. So even if you sell all the public buildings or the public assets, it's not enough to reimburse all the public debt. So it means that the private wealth owners, in effect, through the public debt that they own, through the financial system, they own all the public infrastructure. And even more. So it means they also own part of the future tax payment of the taxpayers. Okay, so this means that private property is becoming very important. So, you know, I'm not saying that 20% or 30% share of public property, like in China today, or 20% like in the West in the 50s, 60s, 70s, is necessarily the optimum. But I think negative public wealth is probably too small. So here, these are issues which we don't talk a lot about, but which I think in the long run are very important for the ability of government to invest in infrastructure, invest in education, and other policies for the future. So now let me talk about wealth concentration. Here I have talked a lot about the aggregate quantity of wealth. If we want to understand the future of wealth concentration, one of the important impacts to have in mind is the gap between the rate of return R and the growth rate. Now when we talk about the rate of return, it's very important to have in mind that not everybody gets the same rate of return because people have very different portfolio and different form of assets. So in particular, so this is for the case of France in 2012, but you would have exactly the same picture for the US. People in the bottom, you know, they own very little and they have mostly bank deposits. People in the middle have mostly housing, and people at the top have mostly financial assets. And you can see, you know, these are huge variations in the share of portfolio. Now, even within financial assets, you have very different rate of return depending on how much you have. So this is, if you look at the evolution of very top wealth holders, according to Forbes ranking, which I should say, you know, they are not, you know, we should not take them as necessarily completely reliable, but, you know, they are more reliable than the self-reported data than you have in a household wealth survey. So, you know, let's do with what we have. What you can see is that I started in 1987 because this is when Forbes magazine started to publish their global wealth billionaire. You can see that the average wealth, if you take a fixed fraction of the world population and look how the average wealth has increased, well, this has increased at 6-7% per year in real terms over this period, which is 3 to 4 times faster than the average wealth and average income in the world, which of course cannot continue forever, because if this was to continue forever, it would mean that the share of total wealth going to billionaires would converge toward 100%, which everybody would agree is probably excessive. So, and I'm not saying it will go that far, it will certainly stop much below that, but where exactly will it stop is unclear. So how do we explain this particular phenomenon? Part of it could be that there has been a lot of privatization over this period. So typically, if you look at Russian billionaires or Carlos Slim in Mexico or you know, in many parts of the world, this is due to privatization process. So the good news is that there is not much left to privatize. So in principle, this mechanism should not continue for too long. And another mechanism is also that when you have higher portfolio to begin with, you tend to see higher return. So you know about this at the Institute and at Princeton University. You know, if you look, so this is data from University on Demand from the US, and at least these people publish good data, unlike billionaires, so we can know what they do. And you can see that first, they are all doing very well. You know, 8.2% return net of inflation, net of all management costs. And the higher you go, the higher the return. So, you know, if you, this is largely due to the fact that you can put more expertise in order to access more sophisticated financial assets. And typically, you know, if you start with, if you have an endowment of $30 billion or $40 billion dollars, and you spend typically 0.3% per year in management cost, well, 0.3% of $30 or $40 billion is already $100 million. Now, if by spending $100 million you can get a return of 10 instead of 8 or 6, you know, this is worth it. Now, if you have $100 million, of course, you're not going to spend $100 million each year. And if you have $100,000, you know, you can ask for advice to your brother-in-law, but maybe that's not going to work well. So when we talk about rate of return, I think it's really important to realize the diversity of rate of return that we actually see in the real world. Okay, now let me move away from developed countries. Let me say that, you know, I think it's very important to have more data access to other parts of the world, and in particular, ongoing work that we are now doing in the World Wealth and Income Database shows using newly accessible tax data on South Africa, Brazil, the Middle East, India, China, that typically official measures vastly underestimate inequality. Now, if we try to understand what are the most unequal regions in the world and why and how can we account for that, what we see is that the logic that I have just described of wealth accumulation, political shocks during the 20th century are not necessarily the most relevant if we want to understand what part of the world are the most unequal today. And we need to introduce one reason why we need to go beyond the Western-centered and 20th century shock-centered view of inequality regime is that in practice, extreme inequality is usually associated with an historical legacy in terms of racial discrimination and very rigid inequality of status, and has really very little to do with the sort of meritocratic modern dream about inequality. So, a very clear case is South Africa. So South Africa, until 1994, 90% of the population lived in less than 10% of the territory, did not have right to move out of this 10% of the territory, did not have right, of course, to purchase property out of this 10% of the territory. So, of course, you start from a very extremely concentrated property structure. And there was no land reform of any kind, no wealth redistribution of any kind in 1994. I'm not saying this is simple, I'm just saying that some other countries did it. You know, in Japan or in Korea in 1945, in 1950, you had huge wealth redistribution. Here, there was no attempt of this sort, so we should not be surprised if we have this extremely large legacy of inequality. Brazil, which is another of the most unequal countries that we have in our database, well, you have slavery until 1887. This is the last country to abolish slavery. And at the time, you have almost one-third of the population that is in slavery. So, you know, this is the kind of historical legacy that if you want it to go away, you need a very voluntaristic policy of investment in education, public services, in a way that is very egalitarian, which we have not quite seen in Brazil during most of the period. In the US, you have, of course, a record historical legacy of slavery until the Civil War, with 40% of the population in slavery in the South up to the Civil War. Legal racial discrimination until the 1960s, massive prejudice today. And as we know, you know, this probably contributed the lack of solidarity that came with this racial prejudice, certainly prevented or at least contributed to prevent the development of European-style welfare state in the US. And many people today are afraid that, in a way, this kind of logic is also becoming very strong in Europe, where anti-Muslim racism, anti-foreigners racism can also diminish solidarity and the demand for class-based redistribution. Now, although extreme inequality is usually associated with an historical legacy of racial discrimination. This is not always the case. There are exceptions. And in particular, the most striking exception is probably the Middle East, where we have done estimates recently using newly accessible data on inequality in a number of Middle East countries. And our general conclusion is that even if the data is not perfect, there is absolutely no doubt that the Middle East is the most unequal region in the world, mostly due to very different factors than racial discrimination, that is due to very extreme geographical concentration of oil resources and pretty arbitrary frontiers drawn and protected by the West since 1916, at least until recently. So if we measure income inequality at the level of the region taken as a whole, we have a top 10% income share of about 60%, which is a lot higher than in Europe, higher than in the US, and even higher than in South Africa and Brazil. This is very concrete. This has very concrete consequences if you compare, you know, total educational investment in a country like Egypt, which actually now it's closer to 90 million population. It is 100 times smaller than the oil revenues in countries with a very negligible population, a few hundred kilometers away. So this is a form of extreme concentration of resources which you find nowhere else in the world, at least with this magnitude. So just to show you these estimates, I should say these are really lower bound estimates because these are based on measures of inequality within each Middle East country, which is we don't have tax data in all of the countries, so we are, this is really a lower bound. And in any case, this is much higher than not only Europe, the US, but also higher than South Africa, Brazil. So here the Middle East is defined as going from Egypt to Iraq, including Syria, including Saudi Arabia. We have different variants of the estimate with Iran, but you know, the general conclusion is extremely robust. Now, this is important because this shows that here we have a complete absence of historical legacy with slavery, forced labor, but in the end, we have even more extreme inequalities than in South Africa or Brazil, where you have all this strong historical legacy with forced labor. So this shows that, you know, modern inequality is really a mixture of old and new. You have this logic of very old status-based post-slavery inequality, and you also have other much more modern mechanisms, in particular oil, modern frontiers, and finance, which in the end can be even more powerful mechanism to generate inequality than slavery and racial discrimination. And so we really have a mixture of very different mechanisms. You know, ideally, you would like to have regional redistribution, you know, through regional political integration. This is very difficult to organize peacefully. And in practice, these redistributions happen in a much more chaotic manner. This is not a reason not to think about them. You know, I think at some point, these debates will come again and again. Regional European funds, you know, it's an example of something that is working at least a bit better than no regional redistribution at all. Now, of course, in particular for Brexit voters, the redistribution that you have was already too much. But you know, this doesn't mean that this is not going to last in the rest of the European Union, and that, you know, at some point in other regions of the world, typically the Middle East, in effect, this is already what's happening, in the sense that Egypt has huge deficit and goes to Saudi Arabia to pay for the deficit, except that instead of doing it in an organized way, through the rule of law, through something that is more or less predictable over the years, you have to beg each year, and in the end, the mechanism is certainly not working any better. So I think, you know, generally speaking, I think there is a Western illusion about modern inequality based on meritocratic logic, as opposed to ancient inequality that is supposed to be based on much more violent mechanism. I think meritocracy is largely a myth invented by the winners of the system, and we have seen that with the access to higher education in this country. We should care much more about real rights to access high quality education, high paying jobs, property rather than purely formal rights. Issues of discriminations are very relevant today in pretty much all post-colonial societies. In France, you have enormous racial discrimination with respect to Muslim names, and there is a lot of evidence about it. And I think there are some debates that you see, for instance, in countries like India. You know, if you go at GNU University in Delhi, you have this mechanism where in order to apply to university, you have a point system depending on your grade and a point system depending on the parental income group of your parents. You add the two and you decide who is admitted. I think there is a lot to learn from this mechanism. And sometimes when we look at this quota type mechanism in India from Europe or from the US, we say, oh, this is India, this is because of all this rigid inequality between castes, this is another planet. Well, maybe this is another planet, but you know, I think there is a lot to learn from this other planet because issues of access to education and issues of discrimination are very relevant also in developed countries. Let me now conclude about with the last part, and well, before conclusion, take another 10 minutes about this last part, about the political consequences of inequality. So rising inequality and the changing structure of political conflict. So I would like to start with a paradox, which is the following. With rising inequality, one should have expected, or one could have expected, rising political demand for redistribution. So why do we seem to see the opposite? We seem to see, you know, more xenophobic populism, identity-based politics in Britain, in the US, in France, in Europe, in India to some extent, rather than more class-based, either income-based or wealth-based politics. So there is a standard explanation for this, which is that globalization and competition between countries make vertical redistribution between low-income, high-income groups or low-wealth, high-wealth groups much more difficult to organize, because indeed you have competition between countries to attract the high-wealth taxpayers, the income taxpayer. And because we cannot do it, so take the extreme case where we all internalize that this is impossible, that vertical redistribution will never take place anymore, then this is in a way the end of a class-based conflict, and then you have a natural rise of the identity-based conflict in a way as a compensation for the end of the class-based conflict. In the sense, you know, if poor white voters in France or in the US, if they are completely convinced that there's nothing we can do about them with redistribution between the rich and the poor, you know, they may think, after all, in that case, if I cannot do anything to tax Microsoft or Donald Trump more, let's tax foreign workers which live close to me, or let's do policies that will harm them. This will be less harmful for me than trying to tax the rich people, and maybe this will not bring a lot to me, but this will bring me a little bit as a compensation. And so, you know, this kind of logic, I think, is part of the story of what has been going on, of course. And, you know, I'm not going to deny that. But I think it's not enough. You know, I think it's a little bit too deterministic and also a little bit too pessimistic and negative. I think there's a lot more going on that we need to understand. In particular, there's nothing deterministic and nothing technical in globalization that makes redistribution and new forms of egalitarianism impossible. You know, technically, you can have automatic exchange of information in order to tax wealth or corporate profits. And, you know, modern governments can do a lot when they want. So it's more a question of political will, of ideologies, and technical impossibility. And indeed, the history of progressive taxation in the 20th century does show that, you know, sometimes people think it's impossible. You know, one century ago, or at the beginning of the 20th century, many people said, you know, it's impossible to have a progressive income tax. And, you know, so, you know, one century ago, there was no progressive income tax in most countries. And then the progressive income tax happened, you know, things happened. And in particular, even in the US, you know, many people said, you know, the Constitution makes it impossible to have a progressive income tax. But there was a change in the Constitution in 1913. And 10 years later, the US invented the most progressive form of progressive taxation that we've seen in the world. And so very sharply progressive taxation of income and also of wealth through the taxation of inherited wealth was invented in the US, partly because the US at the time in the early 20th century was more egalitarian in spirit and in reality than Europe and didn't want to become like Europe. And you know, there is this famous discourse by Irving Fisher in 1919, who was president of the American Economic Association, who was not at all an extreme left-wing person, you know, very center of the political spectrum. And he made this big discourse to his fellow American economists saying, you know, my dear friends, we have one big problem with the US economy today. It's becoming too inegalitarian. We are becoming like Europe. You know, we have 2% of the population owns 50% of the wealth. In Europe, it's 1% of the population who owns 50% of the wealth. If we continue like this, we will become like Europe. We will not be a democracy anymore. You know, a little bit like what Tocqueville wrote a century before about the US. And he made a proposal. He said, okay, we are not going to become like the Soviet Union. You know, we like private property, but we are going to make private property temporary. And his specific proposal was to say, okay, we are going to tax inheritance at 1/3 at the first generation, 2/3 at the second generation, and 3/3 at the third generation. So, and this is almost what happened. Well, it didn't vary with the generation because it's complicated. You know, family life is history, so it's complicated. It involves family history. You don't want to have the tax system go too much into the details of family histories. But in the end, you had a top rate of 80-70%. And this is the same for income. You can see that in the only time in Germany where you have a 90% top tax rate is between 1946 and 1948. This is when the tax policy of Germany is set by the Americans through the Allied Control Council. And the Allied Control Council does the same in Japan. And this is not to punish the high-income Germans or high-income Japanese, because the US government is doing the same at home at the same time. So at that time, you know, this is viewed as part of the civilization package that the US is bringing to Germany or Japan. You know, you bring the democratic institution together with the fiscal institution that prevent democracy from becoming a plutocracy. So, you know, I know this can seem very exotic to us, but, you know, this is part of our common history, and this is not that long ago. So, first point I want to make about the future is that, you know, past history shows that you can have big change, big ideological shift. So here with the progressive era in the US, and you know, I think it was not a war effect. In Europe, in France, the war played a major role in Bolshevik Revolution to change the perception. In the US, it was more sort of internal political evolution, I think. So this, you know, this can give hope that things can change through mobilizations, through reaction to inequality. Now, that being said, this did not happen just like this. You know, this was not, you had organization, specific organization, specific mobilization, which made this happen. Okay, so there are also powerful structural forces which led to this mid-20th century redistribution. And you had class-based redistributive politics, winning coalitions. So you have unique circumstances, you know, wars, revolution, depression, but which also led to structural change in political beliefs toward capitalism and markets. And political organization contributed and mobilized and turned these changing beliefs into action. So in Europe, you know, social democratic parties played a big role, and in France, Conseil National de la Résistance during the war, a Beveridge Report in Britain sort of prepared the policy change. In the US, you have this unique Roosevelt coalition, and this is where I want to go now, where for the first time, to some extent in US history, poor white and poor black voted for the same party, which you didn't have in the 19th century, obviously, and which you don't have anymore today. So this was a very particular time period, which maybe we tend to take as granted in Europe, because we don't have this legacy of race-based political conflict that you have in the US. And in the US, maybe we also take it as granted because it lasted for so long, for a couple of decades, that, you know, it looked like the new normal. But in fact, if we look at it from a longer run perspective, it's not at all so clear that this is the normal. So was there something exceptional and inherently unstable in the post-World War II class-based politics and pro-redistribution winning coalition? So I would say, you know, maybe not exceptional, but at least very specific. And there are deep changes in the structure of electoral conflict since the 1980s, 1990s. Which are not very favorable to the development of pro-redistribution coalition. In particular, in Europe, left-wing parties, they used to attract predominantly low and middle wealth voter and low and middle education voter. And since the 1980s, 1990s, they have gradually started to attract more and more highly educated voters, with less educated voters, voters gradually turn to the right. So let me show you some evidence. First of all, when you look at the determinants, the socio-economic determinants of the vote, wealth, income, education matter, but the most important determinant, in particular in European politics, used to be, and until recently was more wealth than income. Okay, because income is a complicated mixture of wealth, education, whether you work in the public sector, private sector, but wealth is really used to be very powerful. So this is, for instance, this comes from the post-electoral survey from 1978, general legislative election in France, where the left and the right were almost 50-50. And as you can see, if you decompose by bottom 10% wealth group, top 10% wealth groups, it's really spectacular. You go from 70% for the left to 20%. So wealth, property of assets is a very strong determinant. Now, education used to be relatively balanced. So if we look at the same graph for education in terms of years of education and diploma, you see that it was more or less stable, and you have other determinants like religion, or actually wealth, property, or other more ideological determinants that were really important. If anything, the very university graduates, which was a small group at the time, voted a bit more for the right and a bit less for the left, you can see, but it was not very strong. Now, this is what has changed completely, and if you look gradually election after election, and here I just show you the 2012 presidential election, you can see that here you have a very strong pattern where the top educated voters vote 60% for the left, well, for Hollande, whereas the bottom educated worker vote only 45% for Hollande. So you have a clear pattern that you see gradually election after election, which you also see with the Democratic Party in the US and with most left-wing parties in Europe. So this is a big change. If we look at the more recent election in France, so these are projections based on the post-electoral survey which we just got this week and from the first round, so the numbers. So these are still projections, but we know the orders of magnitude are perfectly clear. The bottom educated group, they voted in majority for Le Pen, and if you go to the very highly educated group, nobody voted for Le Pen. Well, you have 80% or more for Macron. So this is not, of course, the recent vote in France is particular because you have 65-35, or in fact, even 66-34, and Macron is not really the left, or at least it is at the left of the extreme right, but it's, so it's, I'm not saying this is the new normal, but, I think it's important to realize that even if you take away, in a way, this Macron-Le Pen vote is just an extreme form of a structural evolution that you have before that, and that you already had at the time of Hollande-Sarkozy, and which is a very strong structural change where the left has become the high education vote, okay? So why is the left becoming more and more the high education vote? You can think of different possible explanations. Some come from the voters and voters' attitudes. Some come from the party strategy. So on the voter side, you can say, okay, left parties have always promoted emancipation through education, so maybe it makes sense that those who have succeeded and benefited from this emancipation strategy, identify vote for the left. You can also think that with the recent evolution and globalization and the rise of migration and the post-colonial multi-ethnic structure more and more in European countries and to some extent in the US, high education voters and left parties have supported more and more the universal values associated to this globalization trend, and low education voters have felt more and more abandoned and threatened by this globalization migration pattern, which have led them to gradually turn to xenophobic right, and at the same time, many left-wing parties have sort of decided that to change a little bit their platform to adapt to the fact that since they were not appealing anymore to this low education group, they better concentrate to economic policies that were more favorable to the high education group. They could have made, in some cases, a different choice. I'm not saying this is the only possible choice, but this is, in many cases, a descriptive matter what happened. Now, is the next step will be that the left-wing vote also becomes the high wealth vote? Well, again, the recent election in France could make you think that. If you look, so in 1978, in terms of wealth, it was very strong. If you look the Hollande election in 2012, it was still quite strong. So this was an election where, you know, the high wealth people will still vote for the right, but the high education people will vote for the left. Okay, so you have a very strong divide between, if you want, human capital and financial capital, or education and property. Whereas if you look at the Macron-Le Pen vote, you have a completely different. So of course, this is pretty special, because when you have 66-34, you know, you have to have a very different pattern. But still, this is raising the question of, you know, whether this can be a new structure of the you know, the political conflict. So you know, does it mean that we are gradually shifting from a left versus right, poor versus rich, to some extent, political conflict, to a progressive versus nationalist, rich versus poor conflict, which is the way both Le Pen and Macron were describing their political conflict, their political disagreement, if you wish. You know, they were both saying, you know, the right and the left don't exist anymore. Now the issue is whether you are nationalist or patriot, according to Le Pen, and whether you are progressive or pro-globalization, according to Macron, with a clear rich versus poor conflict. You know, I think there are powerful forces which are pushing in this direction, which I have tried to describe a little bit, and clearly this is not going to lead to more vertical redistribution. But at the same time, there are forces pushing in the other direction and rising demand for class-based conflict. My general conclusion is that, you know, I don't have a general conclusion. You know, I think this is not a deterministic process. Actors matter. You know, everybody contributes to make a difference, and different individual political attitudes make a difference. You have historical bifurcations can happen again and again. You know, both in the case of the U.S. election and certainly in the French recent election, it was very close, very tied. You know, in the French presidential elections, there were four candidates between 20 and 24% of the vote at the first round. So it could have been different for small events, and indeed, small judicial events during the campaign made a big difference. So, you know, small other difference could have made a difference, and this would have led to very different electoral structure and political outcomes, for instance, with Mélenchon, Le Pen, for better or for worse. You know, I'm not trying to say that there's only one attitude and outcome that is desirable in this evolution. But what, you know, what I have tried to convince you in this lecture is that it's important to put the study of inequality and the politics of redistribution into a broad historical and comparative perspective. You know, probably my most important conclusion from this is that the history of income and wealth inequality is deeply political. It involves political beliefs, national identity, sharp reversals, big shocks. Played a very large role in 20th century inequality dynamics, and probably it will be chaotic as well in the future, although certainly not in the same way. In a way, both Marx and Kuznets, in my view, were over-emphasizing deterministic economic processes leading either to rising or diminishing inequality. In my view, you know, you have strong convergence, divergent forces in relation to education, to wealth accumulation, which can push the dynamics in both ways, and which one dominates really depends on the institution and policy and that different societies choose to adopt. Probably the most important lesson from history is that there are always alternatives, there are always alternative ways to deal with the inequality crisis, the public debt crisis, and you know, I think our real enemy as intellectual and as citizen is some form of intellectual nationalism. You know, many people in many countries, certainly in my country in France, but also in the US, feel that their country is exceptional, that there's nothing we can learn from looking at the experience of other countries because the problem we have to solve are so particular, and I think this is always wrong. You know, I think there's always a lot to learn by putting the study of inequality into this broad historical and comparative perspective, and I hope that the material I have shown you contributes to convince you of this. So thanks a lot for your attention.